it's Amy, and I think it's time to touch base and do another Q&A because by the time you see this, it's gonna be past, but today I actually post two of my lovely Alma bags up for sale. And so yeah, this one is already sold. I will be packaging it in a moment and sending it off to the new owner of this beautiful Alma BB, which yes, I will miss, but, and you guys had lots of questions, or just basically the same question, why am I selling this bag? And I wanna answer it in this video because I think I really need to talk about why, and I think I probably shocked a lot of you guys. I will be talking about that at the end of this video, but let's get through all the questions first. Okay, the first question, Angela Shi. Hi Amy, would you recommend the square mini or the medium large for a first Chanel bag? I am 20 years old and I don't really put a lot of stuff in my bags, and I can fit what I need into the mini, but the medium large also is such a classic and more versatile. These kinds of questions are so tough because at the end of the day, it's just my opinion, and I love that you guys value my opinion. I guess I'm just gonna give my 2 cents and just my thoughts in general, and then you can take all of that and then analyze it any way you want, and also just, you know, try to make a decision, I guess, based on what I tell you and also what I'm sure you've been asking a lot of people around you too. So let's just imagine that I was in my 20s. Oh my gosh, I was poor when I was in my 20s. Both bags are so sought after. The medium large is such a classic, and like you said, a little bit more versatile, and then also the fact that you can just use it day and night, and it does fit a little bit more, as in the space is just a little bit more accommodating, even though there's a double flap. Even though they both kind of fit about the same, honestly, but it just feels a little bit more accommodating just because the length is there and the height is there. The minis are super, super cute, super hard to come by. In fact, I think probably harder than the classic flaps in the regular sizes, like the medium, large, jumbo and such. Personally, if I was in my 20s, I probably would have saved up more, not more than like $5,000 in my account, just because I would still be full-time in school and then just working weekends and summers. And so I would say I would probably get a mini, just because I think at that age, not that bags have, you know, age appropriateness or anything, but I feel like maybe when I was in my 20s, I would really want to, you know, have more whimsical bags and just be more crossbody, just because I, you know, I'm always on the go. So like, I feel like that's what I would get. And I think maybe when I was, if I was in my 20s, I would feel like maybe the medium large would be a little bit too classic, or just I probably would feel like I don't have enough occasions to wear. But that's just me. That's what I would probably have done. But having said that, knowing that the prices will not really go down, and the medium large or any of those regular classic flaps, every price increase will be so substantial that if you wait more, the more years you wait, the more it gets expensive and the harder it becomes reachable. In that regard, if I have saved up enough and I don't mind either style, like whether it's a mini or medium large, then I would buy the medium large, just because I know that, you know, like I will eventually want it, and that eventually I will have to buy one anyway. And it's just a matter of, if I buy it now, then I will be able to save more on the potential price increases, which will probably happen every year or so. So in that very logical regard, I would go with the medium large. But so that's why it's so hard to decide, because it's kind of like you're trying to be strategic, but sometimes you can't. And that's why I wanted to talk about the intuitiveness in you. Like, I think at the end of the day, sometimes we need to look at purchases, especially luxury purchases that, you know, if you regret, then it can be costly. That you need to buy things that really make your heart sing, and that you know, you're not looking at just resale value, or you're not looking at how popular a bag is or how it is portrayed, like whether a bag is too young or too, doesn't matter. I think at the end of the day, you need to choose the one that really appeals to you the most, and that you know you will love no matter what. Because like I said, at the end of the day, yes, maybe the resale value is there. Maybe it's very popular, it's very sought after, therefore you cannot go wrong. It's true, all those things are true. But on the other hand, you're the one using the bag, and you're the one who's had to live with your decision. Bow bow QQ, I love your whole collection. I would love to buy a small crossbody bag for casual daily use. I already have the Mini Alma. Could you please recommend a bag between the Palm Spring backpack and the Twice? Which one is more convenient to use and take more things? I feel like they both fit about the same. I am able to put about the same in these two bags because I am not afraid to put thicker and bulkier things in the compartments of this one, so I actually fit about the same. Now, which one do I recommend and which one is easier to use? I feel like the bag that is more convenient is actually the Twice, because as I said in my review, the Twice here, the front compartment is so easy to access. I don't even close the closure here. I just put my phone and like my mini pochette and just keys and stuff like that that I need to access often, and I don't really close the front, so it's very easy for me to reach anything I need to. And like I said, this is my grab and go. If I don't know what to wear that day, this is the bag that I will reach for. So, and also this is one of my top five favorites. Not to say that this bag is not good, because like I said, this is one of my best purchases last year. I didn't mention this as my top five favorite just because I feel like, you know, it is still kind of trendy. And not to say that trend is not good, because sometimes it doesn't matter. Like I said, trust your intuition, whether it is a trendy bag or not, or a bag that is popular or not. You're the one using it, you have to be the one loving it, truly, truly loving it, and not really based on all these other factors to make your choices. I know we all do, but I'm just saying ultimately that can be the goal, and that would probably be more helpful in terms of like really loving and curating the best collection that is good for you. But having said that, this bag is also super comfortable in the sense that, see what I am doing here? It's super squishy. So like, even though it's kind of like a little ball, like it is really a little ball, because it doesn't feel like a brick basically. Even if you fill it up, it still feels like a little squishy toy basically. And yes, it's kind of a little bulkier than this one, so it could be getting in the way, especially if you're in the crowded area, and like if you didn't wear it in front of you, or if you weren't holding close to you, then it can sort of like bump into people. But this handle is so, so, so easy to just like grab and, you know, just protect it. So in that regard, this one is also very comfortable to use. I would say that the zipper opening, because you do have to like go around the zipper, that it's slightly slow to access compared to this one, just because I use the front flap and I don't really snap it closed. So I do find that this one has easier access for me. Now, between choosing the two, I think it boils down to whether you love this one or not. Because I think at the end of the day, you're thinking about this because you love how whimsical it is. And also, there is kind of like a hype going on where everyone's into the backpack and everyone's into the mini trend, which is not a bad trend to be in, because I mean, it's really cute, right? So, classic, whimsical, and trendy. I don't know, like at the end of the day, maybe think about whether this zipper opening will annoy you, because Ultimately, for me, a lot of bags that have zipper openings really do annoy me, and it really depends on the configuration of the zipper and whether the opening is wide enough for me to reach things. Because if it is not, I get really annoyed. So maybe consider that. And yeah, I guess I love both. I really do. So hope I answered your question, because these are really, really hard questions. Sometimes I like giving my opinion, but I don't want you guys to, you know, solely based on my own opinion and then make your purchases and then blame me, because let's be real, like, you're still, like, in the end, at the end of the day, you're still the one making the decision. But still, I would feel bad if you, you know, just think that maybe my opinion is the ultimate, which is not, because I'm just giving you my thoughts and my experience on them. So hope it was helpful. Jessica: Hi Amy, I have the Speedy B25 in Damier Ben and currently thinking about selling it. Since the zipper opening is just too small, I remember in one of your videos that you mentioned you don't use it much, but when you do, you still really like it. What are the reasons you are keeping it? There's quite a few things going on in my mind, and as you can see, I have put up a couple bags on sale, and that's just the beginning. It's possible that I will not sell any more bags after that, and just, you know, wait and see and evaluate more. I guess the short answer from me is because mine is in the Damier Ben, so it is quite weatherproof, and given the weather here in Vancouver, the you know, frequent rain, I don't really have a bag that is that size, which is, you know, a medium good size that you can carry lots. That is weatherproof. That's basically it. It boils down to that reason. So no matter how I find this strap uncomfortable, and no matter how I find the zipper opening to be small and annoying sometimes, it's still at the end of the day very weatherproof and just like throw around bag for me at this point, just because I haven't found a replacement for it. Basically, I'm just waiting for that opportunity before I decide to go ahead and sell it. I know a lot of you are super surprised that I didn't sell the Speedy first and then instead sold my Almas, or am selling my Almas instead. It's just a matter of sequence. Rima Halal: Hey Amy, love your videos. I got for Christmas a Neverfull MM in Vachetta leather, and last week I got the Pochette Métis. Can you please tell me, do I need to put anything on the leather to protect the leather? Should I put conditioner on it? Have a great day. Nope. I don't personally put anything on basically any of my bags. I don't treat any of my bags. I hardly even clean them because they just stay clean. I'm just very careful that way. I don't really put them in any dirty surfaces. And if, unless there was like a spot and I need to spot clean it, yes, I will spot clean. But I don't really obsess about, you know, having to do a thorough cleaning of my bags very often. I think I only do that when I sell them, basically. So yeah, I don't ever treat any of my bags, including treated leather or untreated leather. Basically, Vachetta or Vachetta is untreated leather, and it patinas by itself, and that's the property of the leather. And if you allow it, it will patina beautifully. With Vachetta, it's kind of like, it depends on how you want to maintain it. If you're not worried about getting stained, then go ahead and just use it as you will. Use your bags, but it will have the beauty marks, basically. It will show the stains over time. I tend to be super careful in terms of like using my bags in general. That's just how I am. So like I don't really get it wet or anything, even if I'm using all weatherproof bags. Other than exposing it to the rain, I don't really do anything else to like, I'm not less careful, if that makes sense. So with Vachetta, all you need to do, if you want to, is to avoid exposure to liquids, water splashing on it. That's basically all you need to do, and it will patina. It takes some time, but it will patina. It will become that honey golden color and brown over the years. It just becomes beautiful, and it matches the monogram so well. And I hope that you don't treat your bags, but if you want to, it's of course up to you. loads of people also do that. I just personally don't do it. And that's just my preference. JS Design, hi Amy, I'm a new subby, love your videos. I watched your other video regarding selling stuff on Facebook. I just opened an account and have a few items I need to sell. How does it work? Since I do not know anyone. Thank you and Happy New Year. So you don't need to know anyone on Facebook. Like I said, you can just open an account. Don't add any of your friends. Just have an account where you can join different groups basically. And like I said in my vlog, if you haven't watched it, I have a Q&A video where I talked about how to sell luxury items. In that same video, I also included all the links to the Facebook groups. Or at least some of them. I have the Chanel ones and the LV ones on there that you can join. Of course, they're all private groups, like I mentioned. All these Facebook groups, they're private groups, private communities, basically, that people, someone came up with and decided to form a group where they can talk about bags, sell bags, or just show your bags, basically. It's kind of like a forum, but within Facebook, and you just need to log on to your account and try to join one of these groups and just wait till you get approved. So basically that's all you need to do. You don't really need to be on social media for any, you don't have to start expanding your own account personally. You just basically join these groups and you will have access to these groups basically. So yeah, hope that was helpful and good luck with your sale. Yvonne Pacheco, do you usually get retail price back or close to it for classic bags that are pristine new condition? What sites do you recommend for a good resale price? So like I mentioned, the same Q&A video that I talked about how to sell luxury items, so I do recommend you guys to refer back to that video and watch it. To answer your question, there is no, guarantee that you will be able to recover the money that you pay for your bags, no matter how classic or how pristine condition they are. Sure, as a general rule, if they're very, very sought after, such as I would say, Chanel boy bags and Chanel mini bags and things like that, maybe things that just come and go so quickly and everyone's trying to get their hands on and they can't, those bags or those items will probably sell for what you pay for or more. Like those are the things that are super sought after and will be a lot faster and easier to sell, and you would most likely not have any problems getting what you paid for. But even then, there's no like guarantee for anything, and so I think it just depends on how well you take your pictures, how well you describe your things, how honest and how communicative you are with your postings. And then you also have to do your research, like you said, good sites to sort of have a baseline to, I guess, compare. I always go to Fashion File to see how much they're sold over there, because that's like a good baseline to see like what's the market value. Y'all can also go to eBay, but eBay, honestly, sometimes eBay, they jack up the price like no tomorrow. So it kind of is hard to, but you still get an idea. So it might not be the actual value or the actual market value, although you can probably try to sell it at that price if you want, it's fine. I think you can still get a general overview just by looking on eBay and looking on Fashion File or other like Yogi's Closet or whatnot and compare the condition. At the end of the day, you have to look at how much you paid for it, how much you're willing to sell for it, and if you don't get the price that you want, you don't have to sell it. Like, at the end of the day, you can decide whether you're willing to part with something that you paid so much money for. So kind of like play around with that, and also I guess it depends on how desperate you're to sell or to recoup that money. So yeah, I wish you guys all good luck. Luxury Lover, hi Amy, Happy New Year. I have a question for your next Q&A. Have you had any experience with getting LV items repaired that you did not actually purchase, like a pre-love item? Do they require a receipt, or what's the protocol usually? I know sometimes LV replaces a bag on the spot if it's a known issue, but does it still happen if you don't have the purchase on file. My experience on repairs and replacements have been kind of different from what I hear from you guys even, or even just from people that I watch on YouTube. I think in the States, or maybe it's not just in the States, it just depends on your boutique or your manager, or if you have a close relationship with your manager, not manager, SA. In some boutiques, it doesn't seem like you really need to have the receipt as long as they can see that the item is in, you know, really good condition, that you've taken care of it, and that if there's clearly a defect, they will like help you out and exchange it or repair it. And you don't necessarily have to have a proof of purchase or have the purchase on file at that boutique. But from my experience in the boutique that I've been to anyway in Vancouver, so I don't know if it's a whole Canada, but in Vancouver, it's been a little different because yes, I have bought pre-loved items, but the only thing that I had to get repaired was a zipper pull on my, I had a Zippy compact wallet before that I bought secondhand. That was it was very new. It's just that the zipper pull had like a chip from where it's like linked to the pull, and so I had them replace that, and they still needed my receipt. And at the time I had a photocopy of the receipt. They were able to look up that person's receipt, which, because they also bought it there at the same locations. If I was working with my SA, she would just know to look up my profile because she knows my name. So yeah, I think it's different from boutique to boutique. In our boutique, I've only always had to provide some sort of proof, whether it was purchased by me or by someone else. Mimi Y, hi Amy, been enjoying your videos. They are very helpful. I ordered the Twice bag online and I'm waiting for it. I'm interested in the Alma BB as well, but you say the strap is not adjustable. I'm only 5'1" and I'm wondering if it's not the right bag for me. Any thoughts? In order to decide whether the bag is for you, I would actually not only look at the strap job, because luckily the strap is removable, so you can technically put another strap on it. I know it's annoying and you have to buy another strap, but that's an option. I don't really use it as a day bag or as a grab and go bag because I have the Twice for that. I also have the Palm Spring for that. So for me, this is more an evening bag because the shape looks that way too. It's very appropriate for that. Not to say that you can, but I'm just saying for me, it has become just like my wedding bag or my evening bag. When I look at this bag, sure, the strap is a bit long on me. I still wear it, it's fine. But at the end of the day, I would look at this bag as a whole and what uses I have for it, and then analyze whether it's suitable for me. Each bag has its own purpose. You may be buying some bags for, you know, all-purpose wear, or you may be buying some bags for occasional wear, so maybe look at that instead. And I guess I understand your question too, because I'm also one of those people who doesn't like to change the look of my bags, or doesn't like to change the accessories that come with it or whatever, or embellishments. So I can understand from your point of view the strap problem. Since you're quite petite, you can still consider the bag and maybe see if it's worth it for you to consider the bag and change the strap, have it shortened, or buy another strap, because they do sell, I think they do sell straps that are in epi leather, this thin one with the different adjustments, I believe. Coffee Makeup 24, just wanted to know your thoughts on if you would get a matching wallet or bag or not. Let's say you have a Speedy B25 in Demi Ben, would you get the Emily in Demi Ben as well, or go with the monogram? So I'm not a big, I'm not super big on being matchy-matchy. I don't know if you've noticed, and none of my things really match, I think. And that's because I choose it based on the item itself. So if I find that the item in question looks best in demi-ban, then I'll get it in demi-ban. Or if I find that it looks best in monogram, then I'll get it in monogram or in epi or whatever material. That's how I go with how I choose my items. And I really, really don't care if it's different print, everything in different print or material inside one bag. I'd never match my things. I do have a preference for certain leathers such as Alpine or Epi, or I really do love the monogram canvas look actually. And of course I love caviar leather in Chanel. So that's maybe why it looks like I'm matchy-matchy sometimes, but I'm not trying to. I really, really don't mind and I really don't care. But I know that can be your preference, so I think it's just a matter of whether you want to do that or not. But for me, I don't really mind. So now the big question for these two bags as to why I'm selling them. This one, I think you guys know why, but this one, I think you guys were all shocked. My husband was shocked when I told him that it was sold. Maybe I'll start with talking about why, how I came about this one. So this is the Alma PM. I have it in the Cassis, which is a purple color, but depending on the light, it can look quite light, but it can also look quite dark. This looks more dark. It's a really beautiful, gorgeous purple. It almost looked like a neutral color because of how dark it is. I love that I could, you know, use it and pass it as a dark brown or like a black even. And I also have a pair of heels that are lighter purple, but I tend to wear the two together. Or I can also wear this bag with blue, and it looks superb. When I bought this bag, I fell into, like, under some influence, I guess, and maybe a hype. When I bought this bag, I had no idea about Louis Vuitton. Can you believe that? I actually don't know their bags at all. I've never really been exposed or never really even seen people wear it in the area I live. I used to live in Montreal, and maybe I don't go anywhere that people wear nice bags, but I've never really been exposed to luxury brands per se, or even Coach I didn't know back then. So to me, when I saw this on one of my friends that I met here in Vancouver once I traveled here, I visited Vancouver once, my first time, and she was carrying the Alma PM in the blue color, I was mesmerized. It was beautiful. I love pretty things. And I've always loved fashion, but I just never knew luxury fashion. And so the addiction, the seed of the addiction sort of got planted. And I just couldn't get my mind out of the Alma. So I think a few years later, when I visited Vancouver again, I stepped into Louis Vuitton for the first time. It was terrifying. But it was funny because Grace was my SA at the time. So basically I had a really good experience when I bought this bag. And also I had no idea about any other bags. I didn't know anything about any other bags. I just went for this one because that's the one that I saw. So basically it was kind of like blindly buying your first bag, or blindly buying a luxury bag that cost so much money, and only realized after I got it that I hardly used it, because let's be real, I'm not a handheld person. No matter how beautiful this is, I don't do handheld bags very often. So this has become my event bag, my wedding bag. Whenever I go to a wedding, whenever I go to like a baptism or whatever, that's the bag that I use. And I think I was holding off selling it because of sentimental value, because it's my first ever Chanel LV bag, and it's because, you know, it brought back memories of how wonderful the experience was when I bought this one. And also it's beautiful. I mean, who doesn't love a beautiful Alma? So that was kind of like the backstory of the bag. And at the time I didn't analyze it properly. I didn't look up pricing in a way. I bought it blindly thinking that that's the one that I love. I didn't do researches as to what other kind of bags they offered that might actually be more suitable for me. I just started getting into luxury and I bought a bag that totally does not work for me lifestyle wise, and I have no occasions to wear it basically. So bad decisions were made basically for this back. On the other hand, now that there is so much resource and so many forums and wonderful people, wonderful community, all talking about bags, there is such an abundance of information and of reviews and sharing thoughts and stuff like that. It's so good that it's bad because it's kind of oversaturated with, you know, social media and beautiful photos, and it becomes kind of biased, and also the hype over bags that everyone says they love and they love and they love. And to everyone's credit, yes, you can genuinely be loving a bag. It's true. There's no denying that. But at the same time, you know, it's hard for a specific individual to know exactly whether a bag will actually work out long term for them, or whether it will actually stay in their collection forever, just because needs, style, and thought process evolve. You may be thinking at one point in time that this is the bag that you love, and this is the bag that you will forever never sell and always use, and you see yourself loving it forever. But then, you know, a couple years down the road, it's no longer the case because your collection changed, your thought process changed, the way you wanna use, or the way you want your collection to be also changed, your taste changed. So like all these factors. Basically for me, the Alma BB is a matter of timing. Because when I purchased it back in 2015, I fell into the hype of like, at the time, I think a lot of people are into the Alma BB, and for a good reason, because it is a wonderful bag. It is such a great bag. It's basically this in a miniature version where you can wear crossbody. So how versatile is that, right? You can use it as a day bag, as a night bag, as a wedding bag, as a whatever bag you want to. And I can still do that, I know, and I can totally keep it. But as my collection evolves, and as you witness, the brands that I love is changing, and also finding out what really works for me. Like, I know small bags work for me, but even within small bags, you know, ease of access and comfort, and whether it's versatile for any occasion. And ever since I got my Chanel Mini, I've been reaching less for the Alma. But like I said, also, I'm not the one to hold on to things or too many of the same things. And for me, I'm starting to get too many mini bags, to be honest. And I wanted to keep it more curated to my taste currently, and to just what uses I have for them. And since my Almas have become more just for wedding bags, even though the Alma BB is super versatile, it has still become just an event bag for me, or an evening bag for me, which was an intended use I had at the time. But at this point in time, I have other bags that I can use for that, and so there is no need for me to duplicate that. I don't want to put any more new money towards my collection. And I call it collection, but it's basically just my belongings. And just because it can get out of hand so easily. And personally, I've never been this materialistic. Well, maybe I have, but only for the smaller price tag items. I basically can't just keep on going that way, and I don't want to keep on going that way because I have other objectives or goals in my life too, and I want to have a more balanced using my money wisely in all areas. And I will continue to buy bags. It's not like I'm never ever gonna buy a new bag if I don't sell any bags. That's not true. But it does really help to be able to curate your collection, and if you do see that there are things that no longer you no longer reach for, then it's just a good idea to let it go. And that's just me. I guess I'm not a hoarder in that way, and if you are, it doesn't matter, because it works out for you, it's great. It's just that's the way I am, and I know a lot of you may be disappointed or may be sad that it's leaving my collection. Honestly, I am too. And it went out so fast. Like, I literally got an email within 2 hours of posting. Someone wanted to buy it. So I will miss it. And I will miss any of the bags that I sell. But ultimately, if the old doesn't go, the new doesn't come in either. Or if you don't allow the old to go, then you can't experience the new. So that's just how I look at it, and I hope that that kind of helps you guys understand why I've been going through this phase, and it looks like a lot of us are, but it's also kind of like a journey in a sense that of course we're talking quite materialistic things, but at the same time you get to know what works for you, you get to see where your style is changing, and you get to develop your true preferences and your true love for items that really bring you joy. You know, like at the end of the day, I bought these because, you know, I look pretty on someone else and I wanted it because I keep on seeing it. But at the end of the day, I feel like bags that I truly pick by myself without so much influence around me, without so much hype around me, they end up staying in my collection for longer, or they end up staying in my collection and I feel like reaching for them, and I feel like I have this extra satisfaction or this true satisfaction when I carry them. I don't know if that makes sense to you. So along this same train of thought, I want to go forward and buy bags that are not necessarily hyped up, even though I think all bags are hyped up anyway. But basically, I don't want to buy bags just because they're popular, or just because they're sought after, or just because they're cheaper or more expensive, you know, that kind of thing. I want to really be going in and then look at something and see, these are the features that I like, that's how I want to go by. And that's also the reason why I said, and I mentioned before, that I wanted my, you know, the brands of my bags to be more versatile, not necessarily just because I want to be you know, like going all over the place. There is just too many great designs everywhere. For example, my Celine Trapeze, I love that bag. I know a lot of people don't like it, but I really love it, and I just love using it, and I feel like it's really comfortable. So I don't know, it's just, see, that's the thing, like I just want to be able to choose things like that, and things that I no longer quite reach for, and they go to a better home. So I think this was super 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 duper chatty, but I felt like I needed this heart to heart, because you guys might get a wrong vibe from me, or might misunderstand me in a sense that I'm just buying and selling all the time, which appears like I'm doing, which yes I am doing, actually I am, but I'm curating my collection and trying to work things out basically. I hope you guys enjoyed this video, and I hope that it answers some of your questions, or I hope that it was helpful in any way. And I want to know if you feel in any way or form, you know, if you understand what I'm saying, like, do you feel me? So I hope you guys have a great week, and thank you so much for tuning in. I'm Amy, and I'll talk to you again in my next video. Bye.